call back to order for our informal session. And today's informal agenda has only one item on it, and that is our superintendent's proposed budget for fiscal year 2014-15. Just a couple of comments I would offer as we prepare to hear from our superintendent and designated staff. We have, as we receive this proposed budget today, we have several more meeting discussions about the budget. And I kind of want to give us a quick overview and some idea of what I propose we seek to accomplish in the upcoming meetings. So today we received the superintendent's proposed budget. We have now 90 minutes left for that presentation and discussion. Our next meeting is on March the 5th, which is our regular monthly work session. However, due to other pressing matters that are equally as important, right as of now, there is no place on that agenda for the budget. Of course, at the end of this session, we will have opportunity to address the agenda. We do have a proposed agenda that's already done for March 5th, but certainly open to feedback related to that. At the end of the evening on March the 5th at 7 p.m., we do have the public budget hearing where we will hear from our stakeholders their thoughts, interests, and concerns related to the budget. Then on March 12th, we have a work session designated specifically for budget discussion, 3.5 hours currently. And then on March the 19th, we have another, which is our regular March meeting, and we do have an open informal session, and currently that entire work session is dedicated to finalizing the budget. And of course, the 26th, I believe we have as a placeholder if we needed a final discussion on the matter. And then April 1st, the budget is due to be presented over to City Council. So tonight, what I propose we accomplish is receiving the budget and asking questions specifically related to what we've received tonight. And at the end of that Q&A period, certainly if there are proposals, if you desire more information from the staff that you would like brought back to us by the meeting on the 5th or the 12th, then we would make very clear to the superintendent what it is we're asking for in addition to what we're going to receive tonight. So again, if there's further information, we would like to see clarity on some of the parts that's in the budget or modifications. As we move closer to the end of March, progressively, we should get closer to coalescing around an agreement for the budget. Each of these meetings, especially the 12th and 19th, we should make progress towards agreement. So we need to be really clear at the end of each discussion what we've agreed upon, what we're asking the superintendent to do, if anything differently, or what information, additional information we need, so that we don't find ourselves bird walking over the next 30 days or so, that we're moving toward an agreed upon proposed.
Explain what that is.
Bird walking,
I'm not familiar with that term.
Sure you are.
I'm not.
Are you serious?
I'm serious.
Yeah, well, most people use that term related to being tangential, but bird walking is going over the same thing like birds do over and over again.
That's exactly what birds do.
Yeah. All right. Any questions or comments before I turn it over to the superintendent to begin the presentation? Okay. Dr. King.
Chairman Houston, members of the board, staff, and guests. Of course, for the purpose of 3.01 fiscal year 2015 budget proposal review, I would like to begin by reminding all involved that the significance for us during the planning of this current budget cycle has centered on our strategic plan its implementation and the forecast going forward in terms of the needs for year two of the phase one, year two of the implementation cycle for the strategic plan. With that said, I would like to recognize the fact that many staff members have been involved in the process throughout, and take the opportunity to say thanks to those individuals that have been involved and will continue to be involved, because certainly the work is not done. We added a feature that we feel has been significant in the process this current school year, and that's a budget committee that consists of stakeholders throughout the central level, also representation from the school level, as well as our teacher organizations, cabinet level groups, across the board, et cetera, to talk about what our strengths, our weaknesses may be, what are the opportunities, what are the potential threats that could be placed before us as we begin to look at priorities going forward for year two implementation. With that said, I'll remind us of the vision that we must always keep in the forefront as we do our work, which is it is to make our school system the cornerstone of a proudly diverse community, which that means that that's what we strive to become. And many times that's looked upon as the long-term piece. The short-term piece that has been important for us is simply our mission, which is our purpose, what we look to work to achieve each day, each semester, each school year, and centers on ensuring that all students are able to maximize their academic potential and become a skilled participant in society as a lifelong learner in a global society, and I think that's a key point. So all those things, believe it or not, have been the driving force behind our discussion and decision-making related to the strategies. Of course, we have seven strategies that lead and guide our work, school and division strategies, the governance leadership team strategies that are linked to the strategic plan. I would not read those to you. Those should be very familiar. We've been working with these for over a year and a half at this point, and they're now linked to the strategic plan, and you will see that if you venture to our site. The last item of importance centers on the five strategies that are overarching strategies for the next 5 years. And I'll just pinpoint just some brief snippets from each of those. The first that makes reference to the system becoming that cornerstone of a community's well-being. There are steps that have to take place in order to see that come to fruition, which means that we have to build a budget that allows us to do that. Secondly, meaningful family and community partnerships. All of those things are important. Building the capacity to see that happen, building action plans and action steps to support that as well. Facilitating engaged learning through high-quality instruction. That's the teaching and learning aspect, whether that's curriculum alignment in terms of scope and sequence with SOL, or whether it relates to a high level of student internalization of the elements of the standard, which means increasing the percentage of students meeting and exceeding the standards. In addition, ensuring that all individuals feel safe and secure in our school environment. That includes our students, our staff, and our parents. Lastly, the fifth strategy to lead and guide our work for the next 5 years, establishing, embracing, and what we refer to as nurturing a culture of excellence, equity, and justice through the process of continuous improvement. So creating the cultural competency and the cultural proficiency that's necessary to see all children across all subgroups begin to flourish. And so with that said, it is also important to do the work in a way that we are balancing our revenue and our expenditures in a way that we are differentiating the decision making based on the needs of our sites in our departments, keeping the student at the core of the decision-making at all times. With that, I will defer to Dr. Thornton to begin with our recent budget trends, and then we'll travel the path to take us back to the linkage to our strategic plan for next year. Dr. Thornton.
Thank you, Dr. King. Chairman Houston, school board members, good afternoon. As Dr. King mentioned, I'll begin the presentation of the 14-15 budget proposal with a very quick review of recent budget trends. It's important that we be reminded of these recent budget trends dating back to fiscal year 2008-2009, because not only did they influence decisions at that time, but also the legacy of those decisions are reflected in some of the challenges and decisions that are reflected in this 14-15 budget. If you look back since 2008-2009, state revenue, again, you've seen this before, state revenue has been reduced by nearly $27 million, or 13%, since 2008-2009. At the local level, local revenues actually have increased since 2008-2009, which is a testimony to the locality or the city council's commitment to maintaining funding for the schools even during a period of significant recession. The third item is a federal reduction since 2008-2009, and this was primarily in the area of impact aid or federal government support for those federally connected students and families that we serve here in Norfolk. And then as you look at the expenditure trends since 2008-2009, the overall operating budget from 2008-2009 to the current year 14 has been reduced by a net amount of $18.4 million, or just under 6%. As well, we were forced to reduce staffing by 602 positions, or people in those positions at the time, representing a 12.5% reduction in total staff since 2008-2009, and that is as of today's budget, 2014. So again, it's important to keep these revenue and expenditure trends, many of which have been negative since 2008-2009, as we go forward in making some decisions on 14-15. The major influences on this budget for 14-15 include state-mandated retirement contribution rates for Virginia Retirement System. Those mandated retirement rates we've shared with you before in previous work sessions. We don't have a choice as it relates to those. We are required to fund those on behalf of our employees. A couple of years ago, our employees assumed an increase in their VRS contribution of 5%. So the employees have already absorbed their mandated share since 2012-13, and now going forward, increases to those rates have to be absorbed by the school division. The next significant influence on this budget document that you have before you is a need to begin to restore a number of state-mandated instructional technology resource teaching positions. We'll get into more detail as it relates to the number of positions and the cost in subsequent slides. And then third, once again, we're seeing an increase, a projected increase in health insurance costs. The next item influence, the addition of locally funded school nurses. We'll talk more about that as we proceed. And then the last two items there, the addition of grade 8 at Crossroads K-8 school. And then finally, the continued implementation of the division's 5-year strategic plan. And some of the staffing and resource implications are reflected in this proposal. What this proposal supports, again, it supports the mandatory cost increases associated with the Virginia Retirement System, increases in health insurance, restoring state-mandated instructional technology resource teaching positions, continued phase-in of locally funded school nurses, and again, the addition of grade 8 at Crossroads K-8 school. And each of these items that are proposed for funding support, you see the school board and division priorities and strategic plan strategies that are referenced for those particular items. The key, as Dr. King mentioned, is that as we make these decisions and these proposals and recommendations, they should be aligned with the division's priorities and 5-year strategic plan. Additionally, what this proposal supports, improvements in technology infrastructure and support. And you can see the related school board priority, strategic plan, and the action plan within those strategic plans. It also supports the increased professional development for teachers and school leadership, expansion of preschool slots for four-year-olds in the city, and then year one cost of implementing a new open campus high school academy. Again, you see the division priorities and related and aligned strategic plan strategies and action plans for each of those. What this proposal does not include, obviously because of funding restrictions and prior year reductions, this fund proposal does not include reductions to core instructional programs. That's a positive. We've tried to mitigate the impact on classroom instruction, and this proposal, we believe, does that. The last three items there, additional funding for facility maintenance and improvements are not included in this proposal, nor is additional funding for school bus replacements and increases for staff compensation. So there are several items that this proposal includes, many of which are mandated, but there are several items that are not included as it relates to facilities, school bus replacements, and staff compensation. As we look at the big picture of all of the major funds, FY14-15, we operate four major funds, the largest of which is about 85%, $321.1 million for operating budget, and you'll see more details in the next slides to come. The grant fund, including our major federal grants, including Title I, Title VI-B, which is our special education grant, and others related to career and technical. And then third, the child nutrition fund. This is a self-sustaining fund. And then fourth, the capital improvement school maintenance fund of $3 million, for a total of all four funds proposed, $375.4 million. And you can see a graphical illustration of those funds. Again, the disproportionate amount of those funds are in the operating fund, which is the focus of our presentation today and subsequent work sessions. And then as we look at the proposed revenue for the operating budget for next year, you've seen this slide. It's been updated slightly, but if I turn your attention to the bottom line for next year, again, the proposed operating revenue for next year is $321.1 million, representing a $9.1 million increase over the current year, or just under a 3% increase as compared to this year's operating revenues. And within that total, of course, we have three major revenue sources, and that would be the locality, those funds that are provided directly through city appropriations as funded by our local taxpayers. This proposal would request $126.2 million, which is an $11.1 million increase over the current year local support level. Again, represent a 9.6% increase over current year local funding. And you'll have more detail to explain how we got to that point where we feel as though in order to fully fund this proposal, it would require an additional $11.1 million from the city through city appropriations. As well, the other major revenue source is state funding. For next year, based on former Governor McDonald's proposed budget that he introduced in December, which is currently being amended by both the House and the Senate versions and ultimately by the General Assembly. But this budget is prepared based on what we know to date, which is former Governor McDonald's estimate of funding for schools. Next year is $181.9 million. Which represents a very modest increase for Norfolk Public Schools of $1.6 million, I'm rounding, $1.6 million or just under 1%, 0.9% when compared to this year. And we've shared with you there are two primary drivers behind that. One is that we're expecting to see a decline in our enrollment of 390 kids from compared to this year's projected enrollment as we anticipate next year. That alone, if you will, has cost us nearly $2 million in unrealized revenue for next year. And then when we look at the other categories, federal, other, and reappropriated, you see an increase in federal of $700,000, representing about a 15% increase, and that is based on anticipated increases in Medicaid reimbursements for children that qualify and participate, and the services that we provide, we receive a part of reimbursement from the federal government through the Medicaid program. And then the final item would be this proposal is requesting the reappropriation of $3.5 million in anticipated savings from this year's expenditure reductions and natural savings due to attrition and turnover. This strategy is one that we, as we shared with you last year, is not one that should be viewed as a long-term strategy because it does not create structural balance, but it is necessary, again, to mitigate the impact on direct classroom instruction in terms of if we didn't have this 3.5 to program for reappropriation next year, then we would have to make even more reductions, and it would be very difficult to keep those reductions away from the classroom. The good news, if you will, is that when you look at the 3.5 compared to the amount that is in the current year's budget, we've reduced it by more than 50%. So the idea is that to wean ourselves off of that one-time revenue to at some point get to a more structurally balanced budget as it relates to revenue. So again, total revenue projected for next year, $321.1 million, representing an overall $9.1 million increase or 2.9% increase over the current year. And again, a graphical illustration of those revenue sources. And as we turn our attention to the proposed expenditures, we have the major program categories. Again, this budget as proposed is balanced contingent upon receiving the additional funding from the city. So within those operating expenditures totaling $321.1 million, we have instructional support, which is the actual day-to-day classroom instruction, all of those report systems that are in place for that program, $239.8 million, which represents a $4.7 million or 2% increase over the current year instructional program. And again, we'll get into more detail in the slides to come. The next category, student attendance and health, an increase of $925,000 to support primarily the additional school nurse positions that are in this proposal. Pupil transportation, a very modest increase when you factor in the changes in the VRS rates and the health insurance of less than one half of 1% for transportation. Operation and facilities, again, a very modest increase to address VRS and or Virginia Retirement System cost increases in health insurance, just over 1%. And then information technology. Next year, this proposal would provide $14.1 million, representing a $3.5 million net increase over the current year information technology budget, representing a 33% increase. And then the last two items there, debt service for construction, technology, and infrastructure. You'll recall that this year, for the first time, the City Council provided additional support in anticipation of the debt service associated with future, with our plans for new construction. And right now we are, based on our unofficial conversations with city staff, we are assuming level funding in that area. And then finally, central administration. This is an area that you can see, it's the only area on the under the major categories that will experience a reduction again for probably the fifth year, consecutive year. So a reduction of just under $500,000 or 5%. And again, the total operating expenditures, $321.1 million, representing a $9.1 million increase or just under 3% compared to this year's level of expenditures. Obviously, if you pull out the mandatory VRS cost increases, then that $9.1 million will come down almost half. And you'll see that in a later slide. And again, a graphic to demonstrate that nearly three quarters of every dollar is invested in direct classroom instruction. Of course, in order to transport kids safely to school and from school and everything that happens during the day and in extracurricular activities, if you were to look at this budget and this pie, you would see that nearly 95% of every dollar directly impacts kids on a day-to-day basis. And that was a summary of revenues and expenditures. So the real story is, how did we get there? Obviously, part of it that we mentioned was that the request would require additional support from the city, but we also had to make some very tough choices as it relates to mandatory items that would go into the budget and then those expenditures that needed to come out of the existing budget to reach this balanced budget with those additional revenues requested. This graphic here has several lines on it. The font is probably pretty small for our viewers, but I'll walk through it. for those of us here and those of us viewing. The first box here represents our base revenues, base operating revenues, before we make any other revenue assumptions, including what we're asking the city for. So our base beginning revenue here is $306.5 million. And then when you compare that to our current year's operating expenditure budget of $311.9 million, obviously you can see that our beginning revenues are less than our ongoing expenditures before we factor in any of our mandatory cost increases. So this next box here with the detail has some of those required expenditure increases, beginning with, again, employee benefits, including VRS retirement or Virginia Retirement System, group life, retiree health care credit, and FICA. We are estimating an increase of $4.5 million, and again, that's driven by the mandatory increases in the VRS rates. As we shared with you last year, we would expect to see VRS costs go up over the next several years as we, again, try to fully fund, as the state tries to fully fund the retirement system. At one point, it was fully funded, but decisions that were made in the past now have that fund statewide underfunded, so we have to contribute like every other school division and state agency. Health insurance, again, next year is proposed to increase by 5%, and you can see that's approximately $1.2 million in additional costs. This proposal right now would assume that we would absorb that on behalf of our employees, primarily because this proposal does not include a compensation increase for next year. And I think as we make these decisions, the fact that both the school division and the city maintain the same health insurance program, we would coordinate with the city as well in terms of aligning whatever decisions we make as relates to funding this on behalf of our employees, along with the decisions that the city will have to make as they present their budget. But right now, it assumes that the school division would absorb this rate increase on behalf of employees so that they would not see a net loss in their pay. Again, the next items here, continued phase-in of school nurses. You saw that in the earlier slide. 10 school nurse positions at an estimated cost of $622,000. The addition of 5 teaching positions at grade 8 for Crossroads School. Of course, Crossroads School is now a K-8 school, so we have over the last 2 years began to bring on grade 7 this year and grade 8 next year. So these are the staffing requirements to bring grade 8 on at Crossroads for next year. 5 positions, estimated to cost $337,000. And then additional ESL or English as a second language teachers are needed, 2 additional teachers. We have seen an increase of about 170 kids that would fall under the category of English as a second language in the last 3 years, although we have not increased the staffing, but we need to do that in order to serve these families as they come into the school division. And then the last 2 items there, to restore student data support or SDS office staff positions that were previously reduced in prior years at some of our smaller and very demanding elementary schools. So this is something we heard very clearly as we went through the budget committee, budget advisory committee process. And I think the board has probably heard over the last 2 to 3 years doing citizen comments about the adverse effect that decision has had. So this proposal would restore those positions. And then finally, restoring 5 instructional technology resource positions to begin to meet the standard, state standards of quality requirements. This would be year 1 of a 3-year phase-in to reach full compliance. Total additions, $8.1 million, added to our current base budget before any reductions, $320.1 million. Compared to the base operating revenue of $306.5, we have a beginning gap, if you will, where expenditures exceed revenues by $13.6 million. Before we make any reductions. These next slides provide those reductions for you. Again, beginning with a $13.6 million gap, we realized that we needed to make some tough expenditure decisions as we've had to do the last several years. You saw that earlier slide on budget trends. where the budget had been cut prior to next year by $18.4 million, or about 6%. We have to continue to make cuts because our revenues don't support our basic needs at this point. So again, this next box, we have a total of just under $11 million in reduction strategies, beginning with a reduction in non-school-based operating budgets of approximately 5%, which equates to $1.1 million. The second item there, to reduce current compensation base through attrition, anticipated attrition and turnover savings of $1.3 million. And we also go in our current budget and look at our expenditure trends to see, okay, can we make some reductions in our existing budget based on recent actual costs? And we were able to do that again this year as it relates to unemployment insurance. This doesn't have an impact on our current employment base, but as we go forward, we do not need that level of funding based on recent actual costs. And then the next item, several items, would realign our secondary, middle and high school staffing with recent enrollment change. As you know, we have seen an enrollment decline over the last several years, although we have not adjusted our staffing levels. So this proposal would require that we adjust our staffing levels, as well as increase the average pupil-teacher ratio at the middle and high school levels by one. We shared with you at a previous work session that our current aggregate pupil-teacher ratio, or average class size at the middle school, is approximately 16.5:1. This proposal would raise it by 1 to 17.5, again in the aggregate. And then at the high school level, our average class size in the aggregate is 21:1. This proposal would raise it to 22:1. It's not ideal, but again, it's a decision, a choice that we have to make at this point. The good news, if you will, is that the number of positions that will be reduced can be reduced through natural turnover. It will not require any reduction in force. It will not require any involuntary separation. We would expect to, based on our recent trends in turnover and vacancies, to achieve this through voluntary separations, retirements, moving out of the area, and those positions become vacant. So no risk, no reduction in force. And then the estimated net savings in base compensation due to offering the retirement incentive again this year, estimated cost savings there would be $1 million. And then finally, this proposal would request the reappropriation, as I mentioned earlier, of $3.5 million. $3.5 million is a lot of money. However, it only represents about 1% of the total budget. So in the context of the budget itself, this proposal is only relying on $3.5 million, or just over 1% of non-recurring revenue, if in fact we were to receive full funding from the city. And that would bring down the $13.6 million budget gap to $2.6 million. And then, as the board has shared and we've had discussions in previous work sessions, there are several items to advance the school division's five-year strategic plan forward, as well as to address some of our deferred maintenance and deferred instructional support needs. And this next box here would provide those needs under tiers 2 and 3. You'll recall that as we were going through the priority discussion process, we tried to look at three priorities or tiers. The first priority was, what must we protect? The second priority, or tier 2 as we described here, is, what existing programs or activities should we expand to advance the school division's strategic plan? And then third, what new initiatives are needed and required to advance the school division's strategic plan? Tier one is already included in the budget, so there's nothing reflected here. Tier two reflects the need to invest more in our technology infrastructure and support system at an estimated cost of $4.4 million. The second item under tier two, or advancing our existing programs or activities, is additional support in the area of professional development, primarily to focus on instructional staff and school-based leadership staff for existing staff, as well as we need to have this infrastructure in place as we begin to attract and hopefully retain new teachers and new school leaders. So this is an investment that we believe at this point in time is essential to catch up, if you will, as well as advance the school division's position. And then the third item under Tier 2 or Priority 2 would be to expand our current preschool for four-year-old program to make more slots available for our four-year-old students in the city. The importance of doing this. And then under Tier 3, there's one initiative here to open or start or initiate an open campus high school academy. You've heard a lot of details around that, and the expenditure associated with that is $1.3 million. When you combine those four items under Tiers 2 and 3, the total additional funding priorities is $8.4 million. When you combine that to the remaining deficit, then we have a need for additional funding sources. And this next slide here provides a summary of all the details you just saw. Again, the beginning operating base revenues, $306.5 million. The base operating expenditures, to include those mandatory increases, of $320.1. These a beginning gap, if you will, 13.6. The reduction strategies, just under $11 million. Remaining gap, 2.6. The additional needs, funding priorities to advance the school divisions, and also to address some deferred needs, $8.4 million, bringing our total funding gap of $11.1 million, which would require additional local support that you saw earlier in the summary slides. And again, these next two slides are just a repeat of what you saw earlier, where we have a comparison of current year revenues to proposed revenues, and then current year expenditures by major program to propose expenditures for next year. And the next steps, as Dr. Houston indicated, there will be a series of meetings in the month of March, including the public hearing on this proposal that's being presented today is scheduled for March 5th, followed by a series of school board budget work sessions throughout the month of March, culminating in a scheduled adoption on March 26th of the superintendent's proposed budget with any necessary adjustments. And then the process will move over to the city, where the school board's budget will be provided to the city manager for inclusion in his proposal for deliberation and ultimate funding decision by the city council. And at the same time, we'll be monitoring the activities at the state level as relates to the Senate and House versions and the General Assembly budget, which is scheduled for adoption the week of adjournment, which I believe is the week of March 8th, around the second week of March. I'd be happy to answer any questions at this point. And again, we close with the mission and vision as Dr. King started with.
Can I just ask a clarifying question?
Sure, yes.
So, Dr. Thornton, if we could go back to slide 17, if you could just provide some clarity that I think we heard at meetings prior to this when we were discussing the budget. And that was, I think just for the sake of the folks that are here in the room and for those viewing us, if you could define, or maybe Mr. Coleman, you also described this last week, that the realignment of staffing totaling those 58 is voluntary separations, but you would also look at how that would be done, not across the board, but by program. Is that right?
Yes.
So can you elaborate a little bit on that just to educate people about what that really means?
John, did you want me to?
Well, I'll start and then John will weigh in. Basically, we will sit down, the executive directors, John being executive director over high schools and Dr. Charbonnet, executive director over middle schools, they will sit down with the principals and walk through their schedule based on what the course offerings and enrollments are projected for next year. And then they will strategically determine which positions or staffing or core or whatever the instructional area is that they will adjust. It may mean that they may have to combine some courses because we may have several lower enrolled courses that perhaps could be combined to get more efficiency out of it to reach that number without having to affect our core classes. Ms. Coleman?
Essentially, you hit it on the nail. The high schools will start going through the registration process with the students for the following year, next month. So as they go through that process, They find out where the student interests are, what pathways and what courses they are going to have to take to complete those pathways. And as they do that, then we determine how many sections of particular courses we might need. So that's where it comes back to where Dr. Thornton is saying, you know, that some sections might have to be combined and larger class sizes would result. Or in some cases, if the numbers are so low and the interest isn't there, a course, you know, may be eliminated altogether. And as a result, you know, that would create the staffing changes that might need to take place.
I just wanted everybody to kind of have that as a, just as background as it relates to that realignment.
Yeah, I found this issue.
Okay, so just before you proceed. Yep.
It's a corollary to that. If we approve this budget and move forward on the open campus facility, then I'm assuming some of the middle school and high school FTEs will go down as the open campus goes up. Is that already calculated into this process?
It is.
Okay.
And as well, it's reflected in the number of positions that are needed at the open campus. Yes.
Thank you.
So again, I just wanted to ask that question so we can all have the benefit of that background. As it relates to pre-K, the figure here is $2 million, and it's my understanding that that is to clear the pre-K 4 wait list, if I'm not mistaken. Is that right?
It's to clear the wait list that we had in October when right. This conversation began, and that equates to approximately 198 children of just 4-year-olds. We pulled the 3-year-olds out of the equation.
To follow up on that question, one of the things we talked about in our last meeting was additional costs associated with facility and I guess other infrastructure needs. Has that been addressed, or do we have a way of supporting that?
We are working with Mr. Gay and reviewing our existing facilities in terms of elementary schools because the retrofit cost would be less in an early elementary classroom. And we are working through those cost proposals now.
Okay.
Yes.
So I think it'd be important as soon as possible to know that we're requesting, you know, that support that we will be able to fully accommodate the need that we're requesting the support
right.
for.
So, may
and we've included, within that $2 million, we've included about 10%, about 200,000 of it will address facilities, but until, as Dr. Savigny mentioned, we can really assess the location and the classrooms, what the needs are. But the idea is that there is at least 200,000 in that $2 million to address some of the facility needs, whatever they might be, to what extent they may be.
Are there any possibilities for grant monies for that?
For the facility?
Not for facility, but for operation, because you're talking about $1.8 million. I just did a quick analysis. $2 million divided by 198 is $10,101 per child.
And also included in that $2 million are some of the initial furnishings, which are one-time costs for each of those classrooms. In order to clear the current waiting list that the fall waiting list that Dr. Savigny referenced, it would require about 11 classrooms.
Okay.
So it would also require furnishings and outfitting of those classrooms, in addition to the whatever work may be needed on the structure itself, as well as some of the consumables, the instructional materials and things.
And you're saying that's all included in that $2 million figure for now?
The idea is that it would include funding to support all of that.
Right.
To the degree that 200,000 will address whatever their facility needs are.
Right. Those are just two clarifying points that I thought would be helpful for all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. Questions as much as some comments. First, I'd like to thank everyone for working so hard on this task, because I know it's some hard work to try to accomplish. I guess what I'm still trying to glean, and this is just having seen the presentation and quickly looked through the budget book, some areas that I mentioned before that I still like to see scream out to me. So one is the academic outcomes. So clearly the effort is made to align the budget with the strategic plan, and we can see the strategies and the plans identified. But I think in this document and in our presentations to the public and the council, it should be extremely clear, crystal clear, what academic outcomes we believe we will achieve or advance if we were to receive all of the funding requests that we have on the table. You know, I mentioned the comments before about the pre-K piece, and I understand the direction that that's going. But we still have a significant number of schools that are not fully accredited. And I just want to make sure that the resources and the focus that needs to be there for the students that we currently have responsibility are truly getting everything that they need in order to be successful. And that might not cost another dollar. I don't know. It may be rearranging some resources that we have. But I personally think it's important to try to tie this to our academic outcomes and the progress that we're going to make moving the district forward academically. Number two is around climate. I mentioned this at the last meeting. We don't have anything in here for teacher raises. We know that we are constantly losing teachers. And I was looking somewhere in the chart where the average salary for teachers in Norfolk was higher than Portsmouth, but we know we are losing teachers to Portsmouth. So I don't know if that's a climate issue, I don't know what it is, but it may not be a salary issue, but it would seem to me that if we don't find a way to address that, then we're going to continue down this cycle of losing teachers and losing momentum as a result of that. Which to me ties into the retain and attract both from the strong academic families and the highly qualified and effective staff. I didn't see anything in here that indicated we were making any type of concerted effort to try to have the no loss of enrollment, or at least a projected no loss of in enrollment. We were at a strategic plan steering committee meeting. I think it was mentioned, I don't know if it was 700 families or 700 students that were being homeschooled. 700 students that are being homeschooled in Norfolk, is that correct? So if there are 700 students that are being homeschooled, they're being homeschooled for some reason. And if we can find out and make some concerted effort to see whether or not what the decision or what's driving 700 students to choose homeschooling versus choosing Norfolk Public Schools, that might be an opportunity for us to save $2 million. And one of the sheets that you all had that was distributed was around some of our specialty programs. I know last year we increased the Young Scholars Program, but maybe there is a match opportunity between some of these homeschool students and some rigorous offerings that we have that may be able to impact that, recognizing they have some other impacts down the line. But those are still those main three pieces that I think we should make sure that we give great attention to as we go and ask for additional funding, or perhaps before we go and ask for additional funding. I'm a long advocate of asking for what we need, but I think we have to demonstrate what the outcome is going to be should we get there. So those were the three initial things that popped into my mind as I was during the presentation.
Thank you.
Others?
Hello?
I'd just like to make a couple of comments on the budget. I pretty much agree with everything that we've discussed. We've vetted a lot of these ideas through some very good discussions. I would like to reiterate Mr. Jordan's comments about retaining and attracting families to the district. As Dr. Thornton alluded, we've lost 390 students this past year, and we're still projected to decline our student enrollment. And I know that we, in addition to this proposed operating budget, we are going to propose also a five-year outlook. And whether it be this year or within the five-year outlook, I would like for us to begin looking at ways that we can attract strong families back to Norfolk Public Schools, whether that be in opening some pre-K spots for non-Title I qualifying students and charging a nominal tuition fee. And if that means opening up spots in some of our specialty programs, such as the EVMS Magnet Program or the Young Scholars Program, International Studies, any of our highlighted programs, the IB program, I think we should consider that. But otherwise, I think that the proposed budget is sound. It is in alignment with the strategic plan. And for the resources that we're receiving, I know that Dr. King and his administration is trying to do the best with what they have. And we are maintaining the math and reading specialist, and we are maintaining the safety net funds. So I think that that is something that we're going to continue to do as we hopefully realize the successes of those initiatives that we're funding. That's it.
Thank you. Others?
Yes. Okay. Dr. Thornton, you mentioned in your proposal that what was not included is the additional funding for school bus replacement. I know that we have an aging fleet. What is your thinking about that in terms of what we're looking at here?
Well, in speaking with Mr. Primero, who's our Senior Director of Transportation, his current replacement schedule, if we have approximately, that's a large number, 198 or so buses that are currently greater than 15 years. Apparently, back in 1998, we had an influx of probably one-time funds, and we made a huge purchase. So we had a bulk. So now, 15, 16 years later, all of those 1998 brand new buses are now 15, 16 years old. So in speaking with him, if we were to, look at the next 3 years, we would have to purchase about 45 buses a year for the next 3 years to begin to get back on a 15-year replacement cycle. So it would take a tremendous investment. This past year, we purchased about 12 buses in the current year. The year before, we purchased nearly 20. And the unfortunate thing for school divisions the last 5 years, school bus replacements have been an afterthought because, again, to try to mitigate reductions in direct classroom instruction, you've had to say, we've got to delay school bus replacement. We have to delay facility maintenance. So the short answer is, according to Mr. Kleinbell, if we were to purchase 45 buses on average for the next 3 years at a cost of about roughly $90,000 a bus, it would be nearly $4 million for each of the next 3 years to begin to get back on a 15-year schedule. And then after that, maybe 15 to 20 each year would be back on a normal cycle.
Last year,
I just follow up on that question. We had an MOU with the city just 2 years ago when we used reserve money to supplement our budget. I don't remember the exact amount that the city committed to providing. Have we exhausted that?
I haven't seen the MOU.
That never came.
But what the city...
Maybe we didn't get a memorandum. Maybe we just had to understand it.
They said, and if I may give a little historical perspective, because I've been banging that drum for a while. Back in budget of 2013, we had a savings account of a little over $2 million.
A reserve account
that was designed to use for buses. And part of the budget negotiations was that we gave that account back to the city. They reappropriated it to buy the buses with the understanding that we would get an MOU to refleet our buses.
If we give the money to the city, they allow us to use that money in an operating account with that understanding.
For FY13, what they did, that $2 million, they purchased the buses on our behalf with the $2 million. And then this year, the current year, they purchased, they spent $1 million for us to purchase those 12 that I mentioned earlier. So they have provided some support, but it in no way does it catch up to the major purchases that were done in 98 that now are 15, 16 years old. So we do, the short answer is we don't have a recurring revenue source to address our school bus replacements.
So this is going to be part of our strategy in the coming years to find an answer to this.
We're going to have to.
Any comments, Dr. Simmons? I know that under your department, the transportation.
It is the money. It's just not there. Right. There are options for leasing. Bob and I have talked about that, but there's just no money available.
I do have one thought as it concerns the attracting, in particular, of the students who are being homeschooled. Last year, we suggested that the division should investigate the possibility of providing services to these families as a means of attracting back. And so my thinking was that, and I don't know whether this is, whether we can actually do this legally or not, but that many of these families would be attracted to some of the outstanding course offerings that we have. And so my question is has there been any thinking about this in terms of?
Yeah, one of the last projects that
Mr. Steele was working on for us before he transitioned was that very thing. And we have the research from the surrounding districts in the region in regard to their practice, in regard to allowing part-time students. We've also reached out to the SBA in regard to other issues surrounding that. Right now, that would require a policy change for us. And we are continuing to fine-tune that information, and we'll be bringing it to us, to the school board in the foreseeable future.
Reimagining our department, trying to carry it from imagination to implementation, I have several questions, but I start with a thank you. I want to thank the presentation here, Dr. King, Dr. Thornton, and all staff. It's been very thorough, and you have listened to us over the past several months very well. A little history. As Dr. Thornton made his presentation, he clearly presented that the state deserted us several years ago. Not only did they shift costs to local school divisions, not just us, but all 134, but they also cut support. The federal government cut support. And the big thank you goes to our city leaders who stood with our students all throughout that. Every year throughout this decline, this desertion of local public schools, the city leaders of Norfolk have stood with us. My final request and my comments are going to be to ask them to stand with us a little more in the future. Last meeting, I asked for 8 things. You've almost covered half of them, but there's a few more questions. So some of these, Dr. King and colleagues, are some questions. I said last meeting I would support a budget that had pre-K 4-year-olds of more leading to all. You have that. The question is, do we have enough for this year? My big assumption is that immediately following this budget cycle, where the school board presents its budget after hearing the superintendent's first proposal, will be in May, where this school board begins further in its 5-year looking at the next budget immediately. because we have to look at how do we arrive at pre-K for more leading to all. The question for this budget, Dr. King, and not to be answered immediately, but do we have enough to begin that process? The second question was, we had an initiative, the transformational initiative, that was fully supported. We needed to do more for several local schools. In addition to the cuts that the state and federal government made to local education, we had terrible poverty enforced on because of loss of jobs, and just our students and our families were hurt terribly. Therefore, freedom to reduce lunch just reflects the great pressures that have been on all the households and all the students. I'm assuming that the professional development is mostly related to addressing the transformational initiative. The question will be not an immediate answer, do we have enough there? There were three items that have been deferred over the past 4 or 5 years that are drastically harming the future of the public schools. Buses has been brought out. Technology, you're addressing. Thank you. And building maintenance. So as we look at immediately turning to 2015 and 16 budget to make sure we have enough to continue the professional development for the transformational initiative, the pre-K of some leading to all of those things, my big question is, can we also immediately begin talking about the CIP budget that we have to present and to begin finding out how we can move with that and any supplemental appropriations that may come to address the drastic deferral of buses, maintenance, and continued technology. So those have all been addressed, and I'm so grateful. I can support a budget that has pre-K of some leading to all. Thank you. Well done. We have addressed some of the technology deferrals. We have to go more. Hopefully, beginning in May, we have conversations about the next budget year and about the CIP and supplemental appropriations. Buses need to be included in that. But there are two areas that haven't been spoken about today that I had mentioned last week. Now, that's not bad for y'all to have addressed all the other ones so completely. And that is, it's my opinion as a 40-year educator that the people that make the difference in education are the teachers. And so my job, I see, and the job of all of us, is to remove barriers from teachers so they can remove barriers from students. As Reverend has identified, we don't have any further support. We are accommodating for the desertion of the state, the cost shifting of insurance and retirement. So we are supporting our teachers in that way. But there's one element of our teachers, it's our lead teachers. As we look to how to develop the infrastructure of personnel, we have a few dozen principals, and I would hope that the strategic word that was mentioned sometime last July, called superlative, I think we all know it, would lead to at least the starting teacher salary of our principals being the top in the area. I would like all the salaries of all of our teachers, but I believe that it's critical that we begin making sure that our lead teacher, our principal at the school, is there. So that's an addition to the elements that have been presenting here. And finally, the school board 3 years ago, I had just come on the school board, and for several years they had talked about something called CTE, Career and Technical. The bookended initiatives of this budget cycle are what are we going to do for pre-K 4 of some leading to all, and at the other end of the spectrum, Career and Technical High School, Comprehensive High School. It was approved by the school board, and I don't see the line item. And Dr. King, you've shown me where professional development could support the transformational initiative. My question is that enough for you? Because remember, our city leaders have heard and supported us throughout the decline. The question is the technology support right now for this coming year enough right now? Are these enough? But the question is, I don't see the career technical education high school in the line item that will lead to realization of that. I'm trying to reimagine Norfolk Public Schools in the dream that I think we all believe is coming true. Is coming true, not may come true, but is coming true. I want to see something about the career and technical education high school in the implementation phase beginning the next budget year. So it is the starting salaries at least of principals, K-12, and the CTE of high school. But I am so very grateful for the city leaders of supporting us throughout the real difficult times that we've had. They've always supported the students. And so finally, in May, when we turn to a big master plan, where we have the Dion Richter report, where we have Mr. Gay's report on all facilities, Mr. Sikora's report on all technologies, our plan for the five schools in 5 years, the salary scale, when we have all of that information and we began doing master planning for all of it, for the next budget cycle, whatever, that the things you're beginning this year, the things you're continuing this year, but the two missing items that I see right now that I would want to ask our city leaders to consider is beginning the initiative for CTE, and second, how do we make sure that we have the best opportunity to get the best principals in our city. But most of all, a thank you. Thank you to the city leaders who's standing with our students and supporting them through the last difficult years. And thank you for a great presentation. Everything that I said, you heard, but those two items I still would like to see. And I know we're in a process here, and thanks for listening.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions just before.
The insurance cost,
yes.
Is that estimated as with most years this time of the year?
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Yes. Based on what consultation with our independent consultant,
mm-hmm.
Based on recent trends,
okay.
That's what our placeholder is.
Okay.
Hopefully it won't be higher between now and when final action is taken
mm-hmm.
at the city level. Hopefully that's the worst case scenario right now.
Okay. And save the nets in enrichment, that's embedded already in the, okay. And then, any movement on program evaluation? Are we still anticipating taking a look at that, or have you taken a look at it already and have, determined that we need everything we are still doing right now?
We're making some final tweaks, but Dr. Bradley, would you like to respond to that?
Yes. Could you just clarify
that one? Well, I mean, one of the things we've talked about actually over the last couple of years is really analyzing our current programs. Of
mm-hmm.
course, many of them are very costly,
mm-hmm.
to determine usefulness, bang for buck, so to speak, and that there could perhaps be some cost savings in some of those programs.
We have been looking at some of them. Certainly, our resources within my area have been reduced, so
mm-hmm.
we are restructuring, trying to make sure that we can look at that coupled with
mm-hmm.
all of the other responsibilities, and
mm-hmm.
so we are using the services of Hanover Research Council
mm-hmm.
to help with some of that.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
So if I could, I do want to also thank Dr. Thornton and the administration for the thoughtful process of going through this budgetary process this year. I understand it's a bit different than last year, and I think it's been a smooth process and an open process, and I want to thank you for forming the Budget Advisory Committee, because I think that's been helpful for us to hear from various folks about their interests, thoughts, and questions that have prompted us to be more thoughtful as to what we should potentially cut or add based on need. So I think the process has been very good this year. I also want to say that I do think the city's been very generous over the years. They have made up for the loss of the various other funding sources that have not come through for us and that will continue not likely to come through for us for several more years. So, to Dr. Stewart's point, they have stood with us shoulder to shoulder in support of educating our children with the aim of improving our academic achievement. And so I'm very much appreciative of that. I also would say that I know that Dr. Simmons and others are also looking at ways that we can offset some of these expenses with, for instance, Open Campus through applications of grants and other. So while I know it's $1.3 million on paper, I do support your efforts in trying to find some revenue that would offset that, and not just 1 year or one time, but ongoing. I do think we very much support the Open Campus concept, and so I very much want to see that remain on the table as part of an item that we fund for next year, because I think it's a very valuable element to educating our children. And then I will echo a little bit with what Dr. Stewart said. CTE is a big ticket item. It is not anything that we can take in any 1 year's operating budget. nor frankly in any five over the course of, in the course of over 5 years, I think. So my recommendation would be is that in concert with working with the city in proposing our budget to them this year, is that we really relight the spark. We get the spark going again with CTE and with the city, with our school board, with administration, and with very interested community members. We really rejuvenate that interest, because I think the interest is still there. I don't think we've lost it over the three, but we need to get that momentum back on the table and keep the train moving. Because again, I think everyone would acknowledge it can't come out of anyone's bank. It's not a bank out there. So we're gonna have to work with partners to do that. And I really would like us to start that process again, very strongly.
We have grant planning money, correct?
So that's just one thing I would say about CTE. And then tangential also to what Dr. Stewart said is, you know, we have the Maurys of the world that we know at a minimum may be $6 million, not in CIP, not in operating. And I do think we just need to be thoughtful how we work with the city to eventually get there with the Maurys of the world. And I say Maurys because there might be other facilities that are not quite as new that we need to address as well. And I know that Mr. Gay has put together kind of an analysis of what we need to do with facilities. But again, a $6 million ticket item is not in any 1 year's CIP or any 1 year's budget. So I think, again, we need to start the planning process adjacent to the budgeting process as to how we're going to tackle some of these major ticket items in a creative way, knowing that we can't ask the city for $6 million on top of this and on top of that and on top of that. That's not necessarily realistic. So I think that we need to have some simultaneous conversations with various parties to tackle some of these bigger elements that we need to move forward. So, but again, I just appreciate, Dr. Thornton, I think you've been very clear in your communication of what this budget means. I also want to appreciate the cost-cutting considerations that we've put in place, because I think they've been very wise, shrewd, and thoughtful. Not reckless by any means, and I know that we're looking at more, and I think we always need to be perfectly honest, because you know we just don't even know what the next year will hold. So I would just encourage us to continue to look with that as well. But with that, I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. Obviously, when you have to go through this cost cutting and program reduction and reduction in force 4 or 5 consecutive years, it becomes increasingly more challenging. Especially as you are also at the same time seeking to address the overwhelming challenges that we're confronted with, as well as making constant improvements to the delivery of education. Thanks and gratitude, certainly in order, for the fine work that's been done so far. So in terms of next steps, I would ask first the question, is there anything in tonight's proposed budget that gives you heartburn? Yes.
Without seeing a line item in there that has something that's going to move us from imagination to implementation of CTE, I feel heartburn. Slight heartburn. I would like to see the beginning teacher salary for principals as a possible line item. But the CTE, for me, gives me heartburn, because without a line that tells me we're moving there, that we're going to realize it, I think it's hard to ask Dr. King to keep it rolling. But again, my question, Mr. Chairman, is of the superintendent, is it enough to help pre-K-4 move from some to all? Is what we have in there enough? And is it enough to help you make sure that those, that we provide more for those transformational schools through professional development? I just asked those questions because if we're going to be asking for more than the superintendent has presented here, I certainly would love to be blamed for it and love to beg for it. But those are the two areas that I would add. But I would want to make sure that moving from pre-K to more to pre-K for all, that we have enough according to the superintendent and his colleagues, and that we have enough for the transformational initiative. But CTE and the superlative salaries for principals, I just am looking down the road, and several years from now, 4 or 5 years from now, when some of our principals retire, I want to make sure we have in our quiver what's necessary to replace them for the best.
We accept your volunteerism to accept the blame and do the begging.
My checkbook is ready.
Okay. Yes.
When will we see the proposed five-year budget that will accompany this year's operating budget to City Council?
Now, I think we may be not in total understanding in terms of what we do with the multi-year budget. That's not something we were planning to submit to the council. That would be developed for our own planning purposes as a governance team. But the multi-year budget wouldn't be presented to council. But as Dr. Stewart indicated, I think it is important that we begin to take those multi-year needs and begin to lay out a plan so that things like CTE and CIP, technology and those things, we begin to see incrementally how over the next 5 years we want to implement those and encourage those items in implement and integrate those needs into the budget. But it wouldn't be a part of what we submit to council.
So you don't think that the council would want to see some type of a snapshot as to how we're looking at distributing funds for professional development over the next 5 years, pre-K over the next 5 years, CTE over the next 5 years.
I mean, as an FYI document, not as an official document with the budget, though.
Simply an FYI document.
Right. And I think after we've kind of laid that out, most definitely, I think it would be both of interest and wisdom on our part. But again, I just want to be clear that it wouldn't be a part of the fiscal year budget.
So that they could see it.
Right.
Yeah, I'm with Noel on that. I think for transparency's sake and for just informational sake, it would be a good thing to add as just a part of the packet that we're not asking for, but it's an awareness.
So I understand, but it's just FYI, this is what we're working on. Because that's where I was looking at CTE. I was looking at CTE as not necessarily in our operating budget, but as forming the coalition together to start the discussions on who's going to be on the fundraising committee, who is going to be on, you know,
And what we'll do on an agenda in the next couple of months is I'll be sure and bring you up to speed on what has transpired thus far. I think it would be good to invite Barry Bishop back to the meeting, and he's always willing to come. So that everybody's informed as to exactly where we are currently. And there is a presentation, actually,
Tommy Johnson will be here this evening to present.
Okay, good. And so you have an idea of both the concept and where we are. But I think it's important to know what we've accomplished thus far and then what do we need in terms of next steps. Mm-hmm. And, of course, a big part of that is marketing communication. And the school is the big ticket item, obviously, building, you know, actually rebuilding or building the school. But there are some other things that we can still do in the meantime in terms of keeping the wheels turning. Okay? So tonight's budget, I'm going to make sure we stay on track because we're going to have to end with next steps. This is where we're going tonight. If there's additional information we need, something we'd like the superintendent and the staff to do in preparation for our next conversation. Yes.
So I don't know whether I'm having heartburn, but here's a concern.
Noel diagnosed if you'd give me a sentence.
It's interesting that Dr. Stewart would mention this. I had the same, I noted that as well, the $719,000 that's appropriated for professional development. But I'm coming at it from a different angle. And that is that I know that we are very concerned about retaining our strong teachers here in the division. And so it becomes an issue of environment or it becomes an issue of the pressures that they feel. And so I'm thinking that professional development has embedded in it these issues that it would address the issues of the kinds of pressures that our teachers experience. So I'm looking where in the budget do we find the kind of resources to address those issues. So I'm thinking that it would be in the professional development area. Is my thinking incorrect?
No, you're absolutely correct. And the five-year projection that we shared with the board a few weeks back kind of laid out the different components that we feel we need to focus on over the next 5 years, and embedded within each and every one of those is a focus on culture and climate and all of those things that factor into morale in a building, student achievement. All of those are embedded within each and every one of those training strands.
And so that's the reason why I would wonder why the amount wouldn't be higher to meet those needs. So that's just my concern there.
That's okay. My next steps, and I can be clear on them, I would love to see the cost of making sure that our starting principal salaries would be the highest in the area. Would love to see that cost and for the board to make a decision whether they want to add it to what the superintendent's already put. I would also really love to see a line item in there for CTE on what the superintendent and his colleagues think would be a justifiable step to make sure that ball is rolling. You know, oftentimes people say what you appropriate for is what you get. Well, I would like to see something as a line item. Again, just having those two items given to us as options, we could find that our city leaders would understand and support both of them.
I wanted to go back and join the professional development bandwagon for a moment in the retention piece. So I think I was teasing with the Dr. Stewart one day, and I said to him that Titanic hit the iceberg and it's taking on water. I think we got a good captain that's going to try to steer us. I'm excited about the, or maybe I should say I'm a fan of the preschool and the CTE and so forth, but I am concerned about trying to add new things on the Titanic when we haven't closed the hole. And so for me, one of the things, at least in terms of professional development, what I feel I've heard from teaching and learning and from the superintendent and others, that maybe the professional development items should be moved up into the recommended, well, however it is on this, into the base budget. Which would grow the base budget. But perhaps if that's what you all see is necessary, that we view it as a base budget item and not necessarily an additional funding priority, if that's something that you all feel is as critical as I feel I've heard over the last 18 months. So I'll put that out there.
Say that one more time.
So on the sheet, we have professional development under priority tier two. So in essence, it's part of the extras that leads to the total gap. So we have a $2.6 million base budget gap. Then we have an additional $8 million of other priorities, which brings us to the $11 million. So I'm suggesting that the professional development line item go up above in one of the other boxes so that the base budget gap grows. The total gap does not grow, but at least it's saying that we view this as an essential to the core program versus an additional funding priority. The other thing with that, you know, we had the Great City Schools report. We've get good information as far as the benchmark piece, and so my heart burns as I'm sitting here is growing over still trying to make sure that the current conditions of our schools and this issue around losing potentially effective teachers, that we find a way to, I think at the last work session I asked about doing some type of retirement analysis to see whether or not where we may most likely lose, or may potentially lose, highly effective teachers in buildings that may be struggling. And then also the pre-K analysis. I just feel it is critically important for us, while we keep imagining and moving towards implementation, that we shore up the hole and right the ship. And so my heartburn is that we may be missing some of that. If I'm wrong, then I'll be glad for you all to ease my heartburn. But I'm not of the illusion that from where we've been, and I think with all the work that's been going, I anticipate we will see growth this year. But I don't anticipate right now that we're going to see the growth that we need to leapfrog ahead. So even as we talk about the great contributions that that we feel that the city has made, it's a relative thing. You know, it's relative to other investments that get made in the city. It's relative to what other localities are doing. And so while we've been doing a good job of maintaining, being behind in the race. And so if we're going to ask for additional resources, if we're going to deal with budget gaps, I like to have great assurance that it's about leapfrogging ahead. I guess I'm using a whole bunch of things now, from ships to leapfrogging, and not just maintaining a status where our children are behind. So I guess I'll tie that to courageous advocacy for all students. And so right now I still have some heartburn around whether or not this aligns with courageous advocacy for all students that truly positions our school system and our students and our city as a whole to compete in the marketplace. And so that's the heartburn that remains. And I would just throw out to my colleagues that while we talk about CTE and we talk about pre-K and we talk about all these other important initiatives, if we don't do something that boldly, as Dr. King has talked about before in terms of culture change and some other things, to set a new tone and climate for the district, I think all these other things are nice to haves, but we will see enrollment continue to drop, and we will see the perception of the district continue to struggle. And I know CTE and pre-K are around that issue, but we can't go another year with 31 out of 45 schools not fully accredited. If this budget moves us in that direction and you feel good about it, then fine. But please, this is the time now, as we move forward in these next steps, that if it's more that you need, or if it's a reorganization of stuff that you need, or whatever it is, please put it on the table so that we can address it.
Is there a specific information that would help you?
Well, I mentioned the assessment of pre-K. I know that Ms. Batten gave $10 million to the E3 school. I know that they're looking at doing some kindergarten ready assessment initiatives coming up in September, and maybe that's something that we should give some focus to, being a part of that initiative and fully supporting that and beginning to phase in the pre-K based upon what comes out of that. But I mentioned already about moving the professional development up, but I'm yielding to the experts. You asked me about my heartburn.
Right.
Scream out.
Right, and the only reason I'm asking these questions for clarity, because if there's some specific information that you like to have, for the next meeting that will help us to move closer to a decision. My aim is that each time we have a conversation, we're real clear on what we need, so that by March 26th, we have coalesced around an agreement and a common understanding for the budget that we're going to present. So that's why I'm...
I have to yield to them, but sure. The outcome piece, really having a good sense, it can even go building by building if that's what it needs to do, to make sure that based upon the current conditions that we have, the results we're seeing from the assessments and so forth, if we have to have some tough conversations around where we really are as a district and what we need to do to move to the next phase with the students that we currently have. I think if that's not elevated enough, let's elevate it some more.
All right. Any others?
Sure. To that point, in terms of the pre-K piece and pre-K readiness, we've heard that from the board prior to, and we have begun to move forward to try to capture a body of information that could tell us, you know, about effectiveness. I would also remind us that, with that said, the results of that will be only as valid as the quality of the programs that we have had in place in the past. Not that we haven't had high quality, but, you know, the whole notion of pre-K and increasing is around building it in a way that it is the very best mechanism for preparing our little ones to be ready for kindergarten. So, you want to give a kind of a status as to where we are now with what that's telling us?
And we administer the PALS in our pre-K classrooms because that's what's required by the Virginia Preschool Initiative. But we did partner a little bit with a different agency to field test that assessment that you just referenced in a few of our classrooms. And I actually received today from Lisa Harris that initial field test study and those results, so we'll be able to share those with you. But no one's seen those yet. They came in late this afternoon via email. We haven't even had a chance to open up all those PDFs and look at it. So we'll be able to share that with you. And in our next update to the board in April, we'll be able to share those that next round of PALS data with you. And remember, we're doing that progress monitoring, looking at children who were in our pre-K program last year in terms of how they're doing in kindergarten this year. So we're able to begin some of those the studies that you had requested.
Mm-hmm. So I'm just clear at the core in terms of, I think, decisions we may have to make. If we're going to ask City Council for $4 million for a variety of things, and we are anticipating that we may lose X number of highly effective teachers, I'm just simply saying that if I'm going to ask for $4 million, and if there's some way to use that $4 million to keep our highly effective teachers from leaving, that's the kind of conversation I like to be able to have. So it's, you know, it's great programs and all of that is wonderful, but at the end of the day, if that highly effective teacher is not in the classroom and we can do something to keep them there, that we're clear when we make these presentations to others, you know, where we stand.
Just on that same line, you've got to figure out what are they leaving for? Are they leaving? I mean, obviously, if they're going to Portsmouth where they're making less money, it's not because of the salary. In fact, nobody goes into teaching, as a moneymaker. Obviously, you want to be compensated for what you do, but there's other things, and I think that blends in with what Reverend Haywood was saying, is that it's a lot about climate.
Well, yeah, and I said that earlier, and I wasn't suggesting that the $4 million or some amount would necessarily go to salaries, but if the analysis said we needed these things to improve climate, we needed these things for professional development, we needed these things for parental engagement and all the other things that the research suggests ties into that climate piece, that if we go forward with an ask, that we make sure that first we have identified and have a solution for all those things that will result in that success. And it doesn't necessarily have to be salaries, but that was in a bigger picture, a global picture, is what I was trying to say.
And I agree with you on that. That makes perfect sense to do that. We want to keep our teachers, but we got to drill down and figure out why they're leaving in the first place. And anecdotally, there are issues out there that need to be addressed.
I think I would think that we are probably traveling in this direction, but I've made notes as we have been able to enter into discussion, and I would think that at some point, maybe today, that or going forward, that we will, as an administration, receive some direction in response to this. Because, for example, I made a note around climate, which attached to it could be teacher raises, which could be costing out teacher raises, which could be costing out the principal piece, which has been mentioned, the notion of losing teachers to other systems, how to avoid that. Again, going back to what I just mentioned, also the notion of the fact that we have X number of students that are homeschooled. What would be the impact of providing choice with tuition, for example? Notion of CTE was placed on the table. Notion of how important is professional learning with the real work that we have to do in the system, and should it be moved from an additional funding priority to the base budget location? Adding a separate five-year snapshot to be attached as an addendum moving forward. Also, pre-K effectiveness and a study around that to determine just where this pre-K piece, which now rests in the area that pinpoints additional funding priority tiers as priority tier two. I mention those things because I think it would be beneficial for us to know if you would like our work to center around gathering that information and providing that so that the board, based on what we just presented, can give us priorities based on what's here? Or is it a matter of having my team to gather that information and bring it back and just provide it, and then we come back for further discussion? So, or, you know, I think that that kind of thinking could kind of capsule our time and control a little bit of time management and decision making around it, if we're ready for that.
And that's why I wanted us to be very clear on what we were asking for. We're not trying to send you out the steam hammer or, you know, left-handed, you know, valve wrench. I'm sorry.
A left-handed monkey wrench?
Yeah, old machinist mate term.
I could use that. I'm left-handed.
So we need to be very, very clear with what we're asking the administration for and its implication / impact for this year's budget. Obviously, there's some work as it relates to analysis, I think, is probably more appropriate for next year's budget. We want to be really focused on this year's budget, and when we end this conversation tonight, we want Sam and his team to be real clear on is there information that we want? Is there something else we want to include in the budget? We need to be crystal clear on that so that when we come back together on the 12th, and take up this conversation, we, one, have the information that we need, and two, know how we want to associate it with or integrate it in, if that's the will of the board, into the budget. Yes, Noelle.
I have 2 points to add onto his list. Your honeybee list. I think it's imperative that we know a dollar amount as far as the pre-K retrofitting facilities. Before we present this portion of the budget to City Council. So we need to know those figures from Rex. And the other point is, I know that sometime next week we're going to get our final report from Dejon Richter. Is that still correct?
Yes.
As far as building capacity, I think that it may not have implications for this budget, but maybe for next year's budget, if we have building capacity for 3 to 5 tuition-based pre-K classrooms, I think it would be worthwhile for us to start that initiative. Because Dr. Savigny alluded that there were 198 Title I students on the waiting list. That doesn't include the other students who were also on the waiting list who did not qualify, which almost a year ago, that was 400. and we're losing 390 students, and those 400 students would then be kindergarten students in 2 years. So, anyways, if we have the building capacity to do that, I think that would be a step in the stopping the drip, drip, drip. So.
Thank you.
Warner?
I'd like to second that proposal as something added to Dr. I love the paraphrase of what the list you gave us. What I see is the possibility at the next meeting of seeing the costs of each of these things and seeing if we would like to recommend as a board adding any one of those or two of those or three of those. But what I'd hope in addition to that and those options at the next meeting so that we could come closer the meeting following that of saying this is it. Again, I just think it was wonderfully done tonight. The listening that's gone on has been noteworthy. But my biggest hope is that we commit as a board to immediately on May 1st, turning to 15-16 budget and to the master plan where DeJohn Richter and Rex Gaze and Socorro's and all of those reports can be coalesced into the next set of plans that's going to move us closer to Norfolk Public Schools reimagined.
Yes, just with the risk of piling on, at our meeting with City Council, Dr. Whibley brought up a good point, and just because I don't know much about it, is Camp Young. I know we're in a position where we need money to fix the hole. Is that a luxury that we can't afford at this point in time? It's just something to throw out there.
Okay. Thank you.
I was just going to respond to the question. I don't want, just for me, and you know, we have to speak as a team, but I just want to explain in response to the question. I'm not asking for additional analysis and work be done on things that Dr. King, you and your administration feel is not going to bear fruit at this point in time. So I'm giving you things that I felt based upon the question around the heartburn. But if you find that it's not worth the effort at this point in time to do an analysis of some of these things, and I'm leaning on you all to tell me that, I'm just like almost, we talked about the reading and math specialist last year. I'm just repeating back to you what I feel I have heard.
Sure.
And I feel I've heard professional development loud and clear and some of the other things that I mentioned. And I just want to perhaps open up the, since we're doing all these analogies, you know, as the offensive line, I'm just trying to open up the hole. So if, you know, if you all want to run through it, then please take advantage of it and run through it. If you feel it's, you know, not worth it and you know, want to call it audible, call it audible. But, you know, even as we walked around today with the VSBA tour, I just cannot get beyond where we are right now with all the effort that's being done with the assessments and the things that we've heard. And if you need more there to help us move at a faster pace, I just want you to feel comfortable to use me as your excuse to ask for more.
Okay, yes.
Before we leave, I just wanted to thank the budget staff led by Rhonda Ingram, Sabrina Ellis, Edna Felton, and Tony Sabatis for getting us to this point. We kind of pushed them in the corner, but they did respond. And this document is a work in progress. It still will have more information added to it, and it still will go through a vetting process, but I appreciate the work that they did to get us here. And Ms. Doyle, I appreciate your compliments on the Budget Advisory Committee, but that was the result of Dr. King calling me in his office and saying, Michael, you need to form a Budget Advisory Committee, particularly with stakeholders from outside this building. So that was critical, and the meetings that we had I thought were productive, and so I appreciate Dr. King doing that and those individuals coming and taking time out of their busy schedules that don't work in this building to participate in that process. So thank you.
Okay. So we're about to bring this budget conversation to a close, and we're going to look at the agenda. Are there any final thoughts on the budget? So as we look at the agenda, we'll kind of look at what's next. Our next meeting, of course, is March the 5th, and you either have a hard copy there, or if you're on board Doc's agenda planning, it is posted there. And we begin at noon with our next step in the mid-year evaluation. And then at 2 p.m., we begin the open session, work session. And first on the agenda, as you see, would be the DeJohn Richter presentation. That's the final report that we would receive, the recommendations and review. We have 90 minutes designated for that report and discussion. And then we would receive the teaching and learning report. And then the school improvement academic review that I spoke of just the other day that we received from the Virginia Department of Education. We get the report on their findings and recommendations. And then other reports from departments, as you see noted, their community engagement, finance and business, so on and so forth. Any questions or comments on that agenda? Yes.
Will we receive the DeJohn Richter report before March 5th? It's for us to review.
So the 28th of February is the report due date. Okay. So, Sam, is that something we will receive prior to?
Yes, I believe so. I don't have that timeline before me, but mm-hmm. that is the intent. You know that we did add the end of this week, two additional community conversations.
That's tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is tomorrow.
Yeah. Yeah.
So tomorrow, there will be two additional community conversations, followed by Friday morning, an additional steering committee meeting. From there, then they will be able to go off and modify options and be ready to provide those, and I will double check the date. So I believe that the answer is that you will be able to receive some information prior to March 5th so that you can review it in prep for the meeting. But I will confirm that.
And who's going to be presenting the school improvement report? Is that going to be
the administration, the VDOE?
A combination of department heads.
Okay. So it's not somebody from the Department of Education that's going to come and speak?
They made it really clear that they don't do that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
On that item, what's the allocated time? I don't see an allocated
That time is 60 minutes, 60 actually, minutes. Yes.
Does that include human resources, operations and human resources?
No, that's just for the VDOE piece. Okay.
I could have known we're only looking at March 5th, but I think, can we look ahead yet one more?
Yes, absolutely.
And that is, okay, because yes. I want to kind of follow on. We get the DeJohn Richter before we have that presented, mm-hmm. but we do need more discussion on DeJohn Richter.
Right. So the next meeting, March the 12th, we have dedicated entirely to budget, because that's the big item right now. And so that's 3.5 hours. So certainly, based on tonight's conversation, I feel fairly confident that we would be able to include part of the conversation. And we almost have to, because a big part of that study was consideration of closure or consolidation. So that certainly should be one of the options or scenarios. To reduce Warren's heartburn, it isn't too late to include this study in some of this year's budget planning, in my opinion.
Okay. And then secondly, will we have, Dr. Savigny, that data you referenced that you have in your email now, and then the future data on pre-K? Mm-hmm. So do you think that would be something that we would have for March 12 or 5, which?
Since I haven't had a chance to go through it, and no one has seen, none of us have looked at it yet, defer answering that until we have the opportunity, but definitely for March 12th, but I can't promise for the 5th until we have the opportunity to look through it.
Just the sooner the better, and if it's the 12th, that's fine, but at least that's during our budget discussions, and so we'll have that kind of information.
Right.
Okay. Any comments or questions on the agenda planning thus far?
I know that you have put way out for our retreat to begin that master plan where we consider all the elements, and I greatly appreciate that. I just want to also include the planning of 2015, beginning this conversation, 2015-2016 budget, so we immediately pick up where we left off for this training.
And one of the things we've actually talked about for the last several years, and unfortunately have not implemented it, is the 12-year, I mean the 12-month, but yeah, 12-year, the 12-month budget planning. And I mean, I think we all agree that this is a conversation that needs to take place through the year, we will have to prioritize it and get it into the planning.
I would say we're doing a much better job over the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. You can see how we start earlier and earlier and getting much more information. You know, the first year we sat on a board, we didn't start until we got information, but really didn't start planning until after the first of the year.
So as you sit down to plan May, mm-hmm. which we don't have yet, perhaps that could even be a beginning item just to kick off that process. Thank you.
Can I ask a logistical question? Mm-hmm. We've had the meeting tonight, and we just gave some feedback to Dr. King. We have the public hearing scheduled on the 5th. Mm-hmm. Will the whatever is presented at the public hearing be what we received tonight plus any potential modifications, or is it going to be a repeat of what we received tonight?
Here's my thinking, and I'm going to ask all entities to give input and feedback. We need to, I have a list, and I know Dr. Thornton has a list as well. You heard a portion of my list prior to that adding of several other items, and so I've added those. And so it is my intent to get with department heads around these categories to work to secure a projected dollar amount for those items and bring that information back, not modifying what was presented tonight as of yet, but we bring that information back, provide it to you, and then it would position us to make some decisions about whether we modify, for example, items that are located under additional funding priority tiers, moving up to base budget, or something disappears from that area, is deleted because of new information that's provided. And I think that will help us inform our work. The only question that I don't think I can answer as of yet without deferring to my colleagues, Dr. Simmons, Dr. Thorne, Dr. Savigny, in terms of this work and the implications, would be I feel that we should be ready for that. We have the next budget session scheduled for budget discussion 12th. Session scheduled for the 12th. Right. My question to the board is, if that is the time that you have that information, do you think that is timely, or what's the timeline on that? That's without asking anybody how long they think it's going to take to collect it. Yeah. So,
I would say the Friday or Monday prior to the 12th, at least give us an opportunity to digest the information and frame questions or comments that we may have, rather than on the day of, if that.
I just want to react. I believe that you can't begin modifying what you presented tonight until we have given you further feedback after the 12th. But if you choose, based on your conversation with your colleagues, to mention there are other items to come, I think that would be your call. But I would not recommend you moving to change anything you've presented tonight until we can really give you final feedback on the 12th.
Okay. With that said, then we'll work to collect the data around the items that were listed and have those to you. The goal will be to have those to you by the end of the day on the 7th, unless my colleagues want to suggest to me now that is not
rational or logical? I'm okay? Okay, all right.
They don't call you irrational.
Sometimes.
The public hearing will focus on the proposal as presented. And it'll be the traditional public hearing. We'll have some summary documents, but then citizens will have their come to the podium and speak.
Yes,
correct.
So as always, there's an overview that you, of course, we began with the superintendent's comments, and then you would give an overview, of course, and then we would receive their comments.
That will be taped?
We will be, where will we be?
Which one, on March?
Granby.
March 12th. I mean, 5th, yes, 5th.
5th is going to be at Granby, and yes.
We will be.
We had not received direction about the public hearing itself, but in terms of the work session for the large period of time before, we definitely were planning on that work session.
We haven't done the public hearings in the past. So.
Right. All right. Anything else on the agenda? Okay. Then the final item would simply be the calendar, so that we're able to look at
the next. This is the rest of February.
Okay, so the state of the city is, where are we?
The state of the city is actually
on the 21st.
On the 21st.
Okay, I know we had four seats. I know Brad is going, Rodney, did you mention going? So we have two additional seats for the board on Friday, so please let Janelle know if you desire to attend on this Friday at 11:30, State of the City, at the Marriott. And then, of course, the 5th, yes, the work session on the 5th. And that's it over the next 2 weeks. That's all right. All right?
We meet every Wednesday in March.
We meet every Wednesday in March, that in the words of my mother, that the Lord sends. Yes.
Unless we finish up on the 19th. The 26th is basically a placeholder.
Yes, and I'm really hoping we'll be finished so that I can depart for my trip to Israel with great shalom.
And a clear conscience.
And a clear conscience.
Take travel.
So, for the 20th, we have the two Dijon Richter community forums, and then the 21st is the...
Tomorrow. And Tracy Richter really worked with us on this matter. You know, there were community members who were requesting additional conversations, both on the west side and south side, and to his credit, he... made an adjustment for us to get back, and then we were still asking, of course, for the final report on the 28th. We didn't make an adjustment with that, and so he's really, really working with us on it. And so, so yes, we'll do 4:30, and then head down to the south side for a final. Yeah,
we'll
Martin,
sit on the
26th. Right?
That's the celebration. That's right.
Do you have the War Jocks Pro on the 14th
of March? Oh, that's right. Well,
that's
March.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank
you. Okay, whose birthday is that?
Oh, sorry.
That's your birthday.
Start putting anniversaries on. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Addresses.
Okay, so
Google
we.
Google Earth shots.
So anything else for the good of the order? And we have time to eat and digest before the formal session at 7. Good work. Yes. Okay, well, we stand adjourned for a brief recess, and we'll begin right at 7. No reason for us not to begin at 7 o'clock for our formal session.
This is a miracle.